Yeah, it seems like.
Do you see something?
Well, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so I just say when it's next slide.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for inviting me. I am a research master student of colonial and global history at Leiden University. So maybe my presentation is a bit different from the rest of the students' presentations. I'm starting to write my thesis this semester, and I choose the subject of experimenting with the Dutch East India Company archives. And specifically, I want to see if we as historians can use text mining methods to reveal new perspectives about early Orientalism and the representation of the other. Next slide. So first, a bit of background information about this digitization process of the Dutch East India Company archives. So recently, about 1 million pages have been digitized and published online as a data set by the National Archives in The Hague. And for this, they use the HDR software Transcribus, which means that users can upload scans of handwritten material and manually transcribe an X amount of pages, after which it's a really user-friendly program to make a model, and the computer can start then transcribing the rest of the pages itself. And basically, we see these sorts of digitization processes in more archives, so it's basically part of a broader development, and some even speak of a digital archival revolution or a digital turn in history. And indeed, there's quite some advantages of digitizing archives, because first of all, it provides access to more historians all over the world, because archival visits can be quite time-consuming and also very expensive. And secondly, it also helps to preserve these documents because, yeah, less people touch them. But it also gives opportunity to search and treat source material in an entirely new manner. So, for example, historians can now search on specific names or places or concepts they're interested in and check if source material could be something for their research. And we also see more and more advanced text mining, natural language processing, and linked data projects arising. And within this development, I am also writing my thesis. Next slide. So first, a bit about the Dutch East India Company's organization and its correspondence. So the company was a Dutch trade company, which had a monopoly on Asian trade from 1602 till 1798. So that's quite a long time. And yeah, it still plays quite a big part in Dutch society as well because of its colonial associations. And the organization was divided into multiple layers. So on top, there was the Gentlemen 17 and the Chambers, which resided in the Dutch Republic. And below that was the Hoge Regering and the Governor General in Batavia, which was kind of the administrative center for all over Asia. And below that were the Kantoren and the Factorijen, which were basically the places where the company was active all over Asia. And each of these levels, they produced their own documents that served as a correspondence with the other levels. And the digitized documents as of right now were mostly those sent from the Batavia level to the Dutch Republic, but they also contain a lot of copies of documents from the Kantoren and Factorijen and can therefore also reveal perspectives on the more local levels the company operated. And yeah, these are many kinds of different documents. So first of all, of course, there were reports on trade and war and politics, but also letters from officials that could also be secret, and lastly, also lengthy descriptions about the areas where the company was present. So, for example, when an official would leave at een kantoor, he would write a memorie van overgave, and he would write all his knowledge about the interactions of the company with the broader area where the company was active. Next slide. And for my thesis, I basically want to investigate how the company described the people they encountered in Asia. And there's quite a couple of terms that are relevant for this. So the first is othering, which is basically the creation of an outgroup by highlighting the difference with the in-group, which is often by attributing negative characteristics. And the second is stereotyping, which is generalized views about a group. And the third is early Orientalism. So Orientalism is a theory that was invented by Edward Said, and it's basically about 19th century colonialism. But and it basically studies the way it studies the way that Western people depicted the East in, for example, works of art and in literary works. And there are now, of course, also early modern historians who are studying how that happened in earlier centuries. But the current historiography on the subject, and especially for the Dutch East India Company, is mostly limited to specific cases and time periods. And for that, we don't really have an extensive view on how the other or stereotypes were present in the company archives. And it makes sense because these archives are huge. So it takes a lot of time to find relevant passages on these specific sort of things. So basically, I want to see if digital methods can help to find these and to get a more extensive view about these phenomena. And for this, I want to look at different factors. So the first, basically I want to divide the data on different factors. So the first is location, which also corresponds with power, because not all the locations the company was present were the same. So first there were, it's a distinguished made by Gerrit Knaap in 2014. There were locations that were extraterritorial, which means the company, they had contracts with the local rulers, but they weren't ruling themselves. So examples of this is Japan and the region of Bengal, which is today Bangladesh. The second is suzerainty, which means that the company was the hegemonic power in the region, but it was indirect. And an example of that is the region of Malabar. And the third is sovereignty, which means that the company had direct control over the population and the area. And that was, for example, the case in Ambon. And then the second factor I want to look at is the sort of documents. So do we see these passages about the other or Orientalism in, for example, those Memorie van Overgave way more than in reports about war? And the third factor I want to look at is time. So for example, after main events of the company, did it happen more often or less? And how do we see that? Next slide. So for example, to give an example of the stuff I'm looking for, this is a passage from a letter from Malabar from May 1732, in which the company describes that the ruler there was very disrespectful to them, and they would have reason enough to never see him again and also to punish him. Next slide. And another example is a letter from Makassar, which I find quite interesting because it's about the king of Goa. And they say that he was actually, they actually quite liked him, but it's his wife, which gave him a bad reputation because, she was all kinds of things. She was stingy, selfish, shrewd, jealous, stubborn, seeking for revenge, and a know-it-all. So that's quite interesting. Next one. Oh, yeah, one back. Okay, so how do I want to do this? Right now I'm working on a lexicon of words based on a sample of contemporary sources between 1602 and 1798. So I'm close reading those right now. And I'm basically looking for words that indicated the presence of an Orientalist judgment or a case of othering. And important with this is, of course, to keep the historical context and the variation of words in mind, because language changes and so does the meaning of these words. So to give an example, honor was a very important emotion in the early modern world. So being dishonorable was really, really bad. And yeah, that kind of emotional connection kind of faded away over the centuries. So what I want to do is to first analyze the occurrences of those lexicon words in the data. But yeah, of course, that does not provide much context of these terms, because another question I want to, for example, answer is if European competitors were described with the same words as the Asian groups the company met. Because, yeah, a lot of what happened in Asia was also based on European competition. And there were times when Dutch really hated the English and the Portuguese. So I need something that reveals the context or the meaning of these lexicon words in the data. And I'm currently exploring engrams, but that didn't really work because often, yeah, the words you're looking for are at a greater distance than you look at with engrams. So I'm now looking at the possibilities to extract entire sentences and do some sort of classification mechanism on that. So for example, if it contains a certain entity, it's classified, but yeah, I'm looking at the technical stuff for that right now. And I'm also looking at the word embeddings, which were also used in a talk yesterday about the archives. So I'm seeing if that will give some results. And yeah, for the final thesis report, I basically want to see if the findings challenge the current historiography. And of course, I hope to provide a new view on early Orientalism. Yeah, and I had another slide, but I think I'm out of time now, so. Oh, should I? Okay, yeah. Yeah, I also had some current problems and challenges of working like this with historical text from previous student projects I did. So what I noticed is that a lot of the existing tools that are available are often not the best fit for historical text. So and also for me, learning like programming stuff as a humanities student is of course quite challenging. And when all tutorials out there are fit for like modern text, so for example, tweets from Donald Trump, it can be quite hard to implement them in your own research. And so for the actual research part, I think that historians should keep in mind that just using digital tools are never the final cause, but they should really help to give perspectives that could otherwise not be given. And we really need to think about what questions could and should be asked. And I already touched on this shortly. The historical spelling, language, and grammar is especially a really big problem for the period before modernity, because those people did not have any rules on grammar and language. So there's like 1,000 different varieties of how a word could be written. And that can be quite exhausting when pre-processing and preparing data for analysis, as well as the poor HDR quality that sometimes still is there. And another problem is how we as historians deal with abundance, because traditionally as a historian, you select some sources and you go from there. But now when you, for example, search on a specific keyword, it can be that there's like 1,000 results. And I think we as historians don't quite have the framework yet how to deal with that when it comes to textual data, because of course there's been quantitative research, but that's been mostly focused on economic or social data and not on text. And of course that most sources are still not digitized at all, so that gives the danger of neglect and a bit of a bias. But for that, we have source criticism. So I think when historians get more and more involved in the digital history domain, they will have to apply that in new ways. That was what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Femke, for a very interesting talk. So I'm asking the audience for questions. Is there anyone with a question? My Zoom is hanging, so I don't see the chat. Is there anyone raising his hand? Yeah, there's one question. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay, you have a mic. Okay.
Maybe it's a bit going too far, but in an interdisciplinary setting, if I look at your challenges,